praise. We give him all the glory, for he's worthy. We're going to take you back a little bit on this old school.
Bye. Love you, Jesus. You are our everything. Let us go to the throne in prayer and give our thanks. Heavenly Father, we bow to you right now. We are entering a season of a new beginning. And Father, we praise you and we give thanks for your Son, Jesus Christ, who came to deliver us. Mere broken human beings, you saved us by his righteous blood. That, Father, that we would adore him, that we would love him and that we would be renewed in him, Father. We would like to give thanks for this creation, this new person in us, that through your Son, Christ Jesus, all things are possible. Father, come into this sanctuary. Let us lift up our hearts in holiness. Father, let us become what you want us to be, good Christians to one another, here and outside of this place. So, Father, once again, thank you, because by the blood of Jesus, his name is powerful. It does many things. It heals us when we're down. It even heals us when we're sick. Father, by the blood of his Holy Spirit, it gives us power to do unusual things. So, Father, that's what we thank you for, because we know we have spent 12 months looking back on where we were and where we are today. We ought to give you thanks for that. Father, we are new because of the name of Jesus. So, Father, bless us and give us your Son, Jesus Christ, and let him dwell with us always. We pray in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Joy, all that's good and perfect comes from you. You're the source of my hope for all I do. Oh, Jesus, you're the center of my joy. Sing it again. Oh, Jesus, you're the center of my joy. All that's good and perfect comes from you. You're the heart of my contentment, hope for all I do. Oh, Jesus, you're the center of my joy.
Let us read the word today. I'll be reading from the NRSV, Isaiah chapter 43. Isaiah chapter 43, verses 14 through 19, from the NRSV, the book of Isaiah 43, starting with verse 19. Thus said the Lord, your Redeemer, the Holy One of Israel, for your interest, I will send to Babylon and break down all the bars, and the shouting of the Chaldeans will be turned to lamentation. I am the Lord, the Holy One, the Creator of Israel, your King. Thus says the Lord, who makes a way in the sea, a path in the mighty waters, who brings out chariot and horse, army and warrior. They lie down, they cannot rise. They are extinguished, quenched like a wick. Do not remember the former things, or consider the things of old. I, says the Lord, am about to do a new thing. Now it springs forth. Do you not perceive it, that I, the Lord, am about to do a new thing? I will make a way in the wilderness and the rivers in the desert. The word of God spoken through the prophet Isaiah for his people. Amen. We would like to welcome in this moment our liturgical dance team as they praise the Lord on this New Year's Eve. Our liturgical dance team.
I think that they have a dancer that's on the way still. All right, so we'll move on with our selection. We'll come back. Anybody know something about God's grace? Carried you all the way through.
Without the grace of God, one witness. Yeah, yeah. His amazing grace. He's kept me
something about
even when I didn't want to be kept, Lord. Hey, hey.
I think we're ready now for our liturgical dances.
Your goodness is running after me.
Let's give our liturgical dancers a hand. Now, as we continue to worship God, we're going to worship Him through our giving. And so we ask that you would prepare to give. If God's been good to you, you don't mind worshiping Him through your giving. Amen. Amen. Let us pray. God, we thank you for every gift and every giver. God, we thank you for this last day of the year. And God, we pray that our faith will remain strong as we move towards a new year and a new season. God, we pray that you would touch every moment of this worship experience, even the moment of giving, knowing that it is far more better to give than it is to receive. And God loves a cheerful giver. God, we honor you, and God, we bless you. In Jesus' name, amen. Ushers, are you prepared for our offering? Are they walking? All right, Brother Roy, will you come and receive? And we'll be in the hands of our ushers who will direct us as we walk. And you can give online. I'm not sure if they're going to, there it is. Some of us have our cell phones. We're going to pay through Cash App, but let us give. Amen. Things come of thee. All things come of thee, O Lord, and of thine own have we given. Amen. You may be seated in the presence of our God. Let me thank God for the presence of the Reverend Gene Tillman, who's here. Will you just wave your hand, stand, whatever you'd like to do? We're always glad to have him in our presence, and we're also glad to have Reverend Chance Clark. Where is he? There he is. Come on, stand and let the congregation see you. Amen. Now, we have a preacher in the house. It's interesting because the Reverend Derek Myers is a trifecta. He can match, hatch, and dispatch. Yeah, he can marry you. He can pray for you when you come into the world. And then he can put some embalming fluid to send you out of here. He's a trifecta, I tell you. He's a very special friend and a brother, beloved. We were blessed in that he served as our youth minister here, I believe for over a year, and did so very well. And then the Lord allowed for a shift in his ministry, moving him from youth minister to the pastor of Philippian Missionary Baptist Church. And so tonight he comes not just as a pastor, not just as a trifecta, but tonight he comes as God's mouthpiece, comes as God's instrument. He comes as the one who shall break the bread of life. And for somebody, before you go into 2024, you need a word from the Lord. Have I got a witness here? And so I'm very glad to report that there is a word from the Lord. After we've heard from this choir and we've heard from Chantel, we will hear from God's mouthpiece, God's instrument, God's conduit for tonight's worship experience, the Reverend Derek Myers. Hear ye him.
Praise the Lord, everybody. It sounds like Sunday morning. Praise the Lord, everybody. We have in the house Sister Chantel Hankerson. You just heard from Lynn Moon, who has set us on fire. Pastor, I'm proud to say that the minister that's coming forward is more than a trifactor. He can play over you as well. One of my former students, and the other minister out there also is a former student of mine as well. So I'm raising up some pastors around here. Anybody glad you made it out all right? Come on, Sister Chantel. God has shown us another year.
You where you were, but he brought you along the way and you made it out of whatever you were in. We want to give the Lord some praise. God, we thank you. You didn't let my enemies. Thank you because I made it. Lord glory for making it out all right. Look at your neighbor and say, I made it. Look at somebody else and say, I made it. Now rejoice because you made it.
Some trials, some tribulations, some mountains, some forks in the road, but every mountain, every trial, the Lord has brought us over. Do I have any witnesses? Do I have any grateful people? For every mountain, God, oh, I give you praise. I didn't get stuck where I was. You cared enough about me. You knew I was going to be victorious. I may not have known it, but you knew that it was a fixed fight, and we just give the Lord glory for bringing us over every mountain. So much to thank God for. So many wonderful blessings and so
ooh, 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 oo Now, come on, let's praise him. Give him some praise. Come on now. Come on, he brought you through some mountains. He brought you through some valleys. And come on now, we're the people of God that are grateful that he brought you through the 12 months. Come on now, 365 days. We got a better praise than that on the last day of the year because he brought us through every valley, through every mountain, through every trial, every situation. We got a reason to give God praise. Come on, people of God. Hallelujah. 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 Somebody ought to thank God for bringing you through. Somebody ought to thank God for bringing you through. Somebody said like David, yea, though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. Why? Because God is with me. Anybody glad that God is with you? Glory to God. Glory to God. Let's give God praise for this music ministry. Amen. God bless you to our sister, our guest. God bless you. And God bless you. So good to have you here. It's always good to see Sister Chantel. God bless you. And her family mean so much to mine, so we thank God for her. And we're praying safe traveling mercies. I know she has a singing Dayton tonight, so you all excuse her, but we thank God for her being here tonight. Amen. I wish you all would. If you don't mind standing to your feet and giving the angel his house, God, some praise for Pastor Jermaine Covington. Come on, let's give God some praise for Pastor Jermaine Covington. Amen, amen. He does so much in our community. We thank God for Pastor Jermaine Covington, definitely. While you're at it, give his wife, Give God some praise for his wife, Sister Lady Covington. God bless you all. God bless you. Thank you so much. And I definitely thank God for my wife who's with us here tonight. Quinn, raise your hand. And my children, my nieces. Got some family and some friends, some people from Philippians. We thank God for you all. And of course, I wouldn't go anywhere without recognizing Sister Jordan, Sister Kathy Jordan. God bless you. Always good to see you. Amen, amen. And to once again to this, Sister Geneva is one of the plainest pianists in all of Cincinnati. I tell you what, God bless, we praise God for her, and of course the band. We thank God for our wonderful band tonight, and Mr. Moore. We thank God for Brother Everett Moore, my music teacher. Amen. Like I say, him and Gene, or we call him William growing up. Pastor Tim, we thank God that we see you all the ministers out here, to everyone, and just in case I miss anyone, to all those who have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God, we welcome you tonight, and I say hello to you. I see some co-workers, some people out there I ain't seen in a long time. Thank God, so good to see you. There is a word from the Lord. Amen. And Mr. Moore, let's find F in this state right there. Wherever we go, just stay right there. Bless your heart. Glory to God. Thank you, sound man. It sounds real good up here. Let us pray. God, we thank you for 365 days of keeping us, God. We thank you that we're able to come tonight to celebrate your goodness. And God, when the clock strikes 12, God, we know that it will do so only by your grace and your mercy. So we thank you, God. Right now, God, use me to preach. God, take over my mouth, my spirit, my body, God, that you may speak through me. We give your name all the glory and the honor that you're richly deserving of. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Like again, it's good to see Reverend Clark out there. We're going to go over to Acts, the 27th chapter. Acts, the 27th chapter. I'll be reading the NLT version, beginning at the 30th verse. You don't even have to stand. I'll read it for you. It says, "Then the sailors tried to abandon the ship. They lowered the lifeboat as they were going to put out anchors from the front of the ship. But Paul said to the commanding officer and the soldiers, 'You will all die unless the sailors stay aboard.' So the soldiers cut the ropes to the lifeboat and let it drift away. Today I want to preach from the subject, safety on a troubled ship." Y'all gonna help me preach this thing tonight? Come on, let's practice right now. Somebody say amen. Amen. There we go. If you keep on saying that, I'll help and get on out your way. Amen. Oh, y'all said that too fast. Now don't. Amen. All right, we'll get you home by 12, I promise. But life, y'all, life has led me to understand it is good and it's much better to be with God even in a troubled place than to be somewhere safe without him. It is good to be in what's considered a bad situation with God than to be in a situation that you would consider good without God. Do I have a witness here? I'd rather be in the valley with God than on the mountaintop without him. Y'all got to practice by saying, amen. I'd rather be in the storm with God than have nothing but blue skies without God. I'd rather be broke with God than to be rich without God. I'd rather have rain and thunderstorms with God than to have sunshine without God. I would much rather have tears and sorrow with God than to have a smile all on my face without God. I'd rather be friendless with God than to have many friends and not have God. Who am I preaching to up in here? I'd rather be in discomfort with God than to be comfortable without him. I would rather have a moment of sadness with God than to have nothing but empty happiness without God. I'd much rather be in difficulty with God than to dance around without God. That's because with God, he can change the situation that I'm in. Anybody know that God can change a situation? Somebody ought to shout hallelujah right there. But without him, I'm doomed for the worst. With God, I can be in the valley because he can take me to the mountaintop. But if I'm on the mountaintop without him, I'm doomed to fall all the way down to the bottom. With God in the storm, he can give me blessed assurance. But without God, I am doomed to drown with every storm. If I'm broke with God, I know that he'll supply all my needs. Anybody know that your needs have been supplied all year long? Y'all to talk back at me. I'd rather be with God. If I got God with tears in my eyes, somebody said that he'll dry all your tears away. Anybody know that God to dry some tears away? The Bible says in Psalms 112 and verse 7, it says, they do not fear bad news. They confidently trust the Lord to care for them. That's because my confidence is God is based on his character and not my circumstance. You missed a good spot right there to give God some praise. My confidence is in God's attributes and not my accidents. I'm confident in his benefits and not my breakdowns. I'm confident in his charity and not my calamity. I'm confident in his deity despite my disappointments. I'm confident in his favor despite my failures. I'm confident in his goodness despite my gloom. I'm confident in his grace despite my guilt. I'm confident in his greatest help versus my helplessness. I'm confident in his hope and my despite my hurt. Anybody know that it is good to have God with you? Maybe that's why this time of year we say Emmanuel, which means God's with us. Anybody know that it's good to have God with you? I can weather the storm with Jesus, but I can't handle one raindrop without him. I can handle a million blows with him, but I can't take one blow without him. I can handle my hardships, but I can't handle one disappointment without him. Anybody know that you're excited about having God with you through every situation in your life? It is good to have God. Here we find the Apostle Paul. Paul was a prisoner that found favor with Julius, the captain of this particular ship that the text talks about. This is the captain of this imperial regiment that was in charge of prisoners. He was a prisoner. Paul was a prisoner, but he had favor with the captain. I wish I had somebody that understood. Yeah, I may be a prisoner in some things, but I got favor with the captain. Who is the captain? Somebody know who the captain is. They call him Jesus. I come to let you know, as long as you got favor with Jesus, you'll be all right. He was given this story. It's talking about when they finally reached Fairhaven, Paul urged them not to try to make the rest of the trip. They were on this ship and he knew that there were some storms coming. And when they got to a certain point prior to this verse 30, he was trying to tell them that it is not good that we should go. That's in verse 10. Paul is trying to tell them that it is not good that we should go. No one wanted to listen to him. To them having to spend the winter, they didn't want to spend the winter in this place called Fairhaven. They wanted to go somewhere else and spend the winter. To him, it told them not to go. In verse 10, he told them not to go. To them, he sounded foolish. And I come to let you know, sometimes in your life when you go to speak the word of God and go to speak in faith, you will sound foolish to some people. Anybody ever been there where you sound foolish speaking to some people? They don't understand the faith that you got on the inside of you. They don't understand the God that you serve on the inside of you. They don't understand that the same God that brought you through in 2022 is the same God that's kept you all 2023. It's going to be the same God that kept you in 2024. You look foolish going to church week after week. You look foolish giving God praise week after week, but I come to let somebody know that when you trust and you believe in God, God will show you that he can show up. That was verse 10. Look at somebody say verse 10. However, in verse 21, the tables are turned, and now Paul has a I told you so moment. I don't necessarily care for people, you know, that have that whole I told you so moment, but there's some times in life where God vindicates his people, and he allows us to have that I told you so moment to where you can look at the devil and say, I told you so that God was going to bring me out. You thought I was dead. You thought I was doomed. You thought I was dumb, but I come to let you know that in verse 21, God vindicates him. It's a good feeling when God vindicates you in front of your naysayers. He proves you were right in front of the people who swore you were wrong. In verse 10, you look stupid, but in verse 20, you look smart. In verse 10, you look too young to know what you're talking about, but in verse 21, you look like God was speaking through you. Who am I talking to in here? In verse 10, you sound incompetent, but in verse 21, you sound knowledgeable. In verse 10, Noah was being laughed at for building the ark, but in verse 21, people are begging to get on the ark. In verse 10, Moses had been ridiculed for bringing the Israelites out of Egypt, but in verse 21, the people are seeing the waters of the Red Sea swallow up the Egyptian. I come to talk to somebody in verse 10 feels embarrassed. In verse 10 feels shunned. Verse 10 feels dismissed. Verse 10 feels overlooked. But verse 21 feels like vindication. Verse 21 feels like approval. Verse 21 feels like being exalted. In verse 10, he was told to shut up.
But in verse 21, he was told to speak up. I wish I had a praying church somewhere in here that know it's time for the people of God to speak up. It's time for the people of God to speak out. It's time for the people of God to lift their voices and begin to speak in faith. In verse 10, he was held captive. But in verse 21, he became the captain. I come to let somebody know God's going to turn the table on some things. Anybody need God to turn the table on some things? You in verse 10 right now. You experiencing some hardship. You experiencing being looked down. But you know at some point in time, God's going to turn that thing around. I believe the song said late in the midnight hour. God's going to turn it around. It's going to work in your favor. Anybody know that God's going to work things in your favor? God's going to turn that thing around for you. If you believe it, say yeah. He was held captive, and then God flipped that thing around, and he became the captain. God proved to the others that Paul's voice was important, and at the right time, God is going to show them that you weren't a fool for speaking the truth. You weren't a fool for speaking out in faith. You weren't a fool for believing that God could supply all your needs despite the fact that you had nothing. You weren't a fool for believing that God would touch your body despite what the doctor said. I come to let somebody know that at the right time, God's going to turn that thing around. People are going to have to apologize for calling you foolish. Now, although Paul wasn't in charge of the boat, he still had a job to do, and that was to speak on God's behalf. I come to let you know, no matter how bad it gets, no matter how much people try to shun you or shush you, you have got to speak the word of God over every situation. You've got to speak the word of God into every situation. Look at your neighbor and say, I may not be in charge, but I got a charge to keep. I got a God to glorify. Come on, church. I wish I had somebody that'll help me preach this thing. I got to speak up for God. I got to say what's right. I got to understand and speak out that there is safety even on a troubled ship. Paul had to remind these people that there is safety even on the troubled ship. And sometimes we put ourselves in these situations, and you probably can look back over the course of 2023 and you understand you put yourself in some bad situations. You put yourself in some bad ships, and you understand that even though you did that, God is still grace and there is still safety on a troubled ship. Well, if they're going to secure that safety on the troubled ship, Paul showed us right then and there, the first thing you got to do is get anchored. Look at somebody and say, get anchored. Oh, come on. Y'all know what it is. You got to get anchored. In verse 29, in verses 1 through 6 of the 27th chapter, we see that Paul and the other men had plans to go one direction. But the storm came and took them in another direction. That sound like anybody's life? You had plans to go one way. And then life came. Oh, I ain't got nobody here. Maybe some people on this side. You understand that in 2023, you had one vision. You had created your vision board. You said what you wanted to do. And by time you got to January 12th, life came and turned that thing around. Maybe there's some people on this side that understand that sometimes life will take you in a different direction than what you wanted to go. Paul and the men that had control of him had a plan to go to Italy. He was trying to appeal in Italy to try to, he was put in jail for preaching the word of God. They were not unprepared and just aimlessly sailing. It wasn't that they were unprepared. They had made plans. However, unpreparedness or a lack of direction is not a prerequisite for a storm finding you. I don't care how much money you got in the bank, the storm gonna find you. I don't care how good that wig look on your head when you put it on, that storm gonna find you. I don't care how well you glued them eyelashes onto your eye. I come to let somebody know the storm gonna find you. I don't care how good you look in that three-piece suit. The storm is gonna find you some kind of way. You don't have to be unprepared. Preparation doesn't always call off a storm. It can help you deal with the storm, but it doesn't always stop it from happening. It wasn't the man's plan to be in the middle of a storm. It wasn't even Paul's plan to be on the ship. He was a prisoner because the Jews were in strong disagreement about his teachings. You have to understand that. Although Paul was doing the right thing, the storm had its way with them. They were headed for Italy, but were but went to Sidon, had to travel along the shore of Cyprus and ended up on the port of Myra, where they were transferred to a different ship. They were simply doing the best they could to get to their destination. That sounds like anybody's life. You're doing the best you can to get to your next destination. I'm doing the best I can to get to where I need. I'm doing the best I can to make it from day to day. I'm doing the best I can to pay my bills. I'm doing the best I can to keep a roof over my head. I'm doing the best I can to keep food on the table. I'm doing the best I can to please the Lord. I'm doing the best I can to serve my community. I'm doing the best I can to be a good father. I'm doing the best I can to be a good mother. I'm doing the best I can to be a good preacher. I'm doing the best I can to be a good Christian. But you understand, sometimes in life, the storm will take you in a different direction. But I come to let you know, you do what you can and let the Lord do what you can. You do what is what's in your reach and let the Lord do what's without of your reach. I come to let somebody know you ought to let the Lord do it. So as of being angry, Paul could testify that I didn't want to be out here, but that's where the storm brought me. Some of us are in our life right there, right now. We are where the storm brought us. We are where the storm of grief brought us. We are where the storm of depression brought us. We can't always dictate and we can't always mandate and we can't always have control of the situation. I didn't want to be like this, but this is where the storm brought me. I didn't have plans in my life, but this is where the storm brought me. I had plans to be further in life. I had plans to do something else, but sometimes life will throw you a storm that will push you out the way. Although I can't help where the storm is taking me, I got help wherever the storm takes me. I wish I had a praying church. I wish y'all would wake up. I can't help where the storm takes me, but wherever the storm does take me, I know I got a God that'll keep me safe. I don't know which way the boat is going to go, but I know whichever way it goes, I got a God that'll be with me. I got a God that'll keep me. I got a God that'll pull me. I got a God that'll push me. I got a God that'll strengthen me. I got a God that'll lift me up. Who am I talking to in this building that understand? You got a God no matter wherever you go, God'll be right there with you. David said, if I make my bed in hell, thou art with me. I come to let somebody know that God is with you. I got help. I got those twins, Grace and Mercy, that are with me all the days in my life. Anybody know you got Grace and Mercy wherever you go? No matter where the stop bad the storm getting, the storm can keep on raging, but you have got to be anchored. Bible says for 2 weeks they were just drifting around, drifting wherever the wind took them. But as they noticed they were getting ready to run into some rocks, they were getting ready to get closer to shore, they said, all right, that's enough. Now, sometimes in life you got to get to a point to where you just say, all right, that's enough. And I love the color purple. I always use this. I love the color purple. And when they're sitting there at that dinner table, and then Sophia get to laughing. And she said, all right, Sophia home now. So things going to change around here. Sophia home now. Right then and there, Sophia felt her strength and she felt her anchored, get anchored right then and there. And every time, sometimes in your life, you got to get to the point where you say, oh, Sophia home now. Some things getting ready to change. Sophia home right now. Who am I talking to? You got to go back to your situation. Say, all right, I'm home now. Things got to change around here. You've got to be anchored in the Lord. If you want to stop being tossed around by the winds and the currents, you've got to anchor yourself in the Lord. You've got to anchor yourself in His Word. You've got to anchor yourself in His Spirit. You've got to anchor yourself in worship. You've got to anchor yourself in praise. You've got to anchor your mind. Your mind needs to be anchored. Your spirit needs to be anchored. Your heart needs to be anchored. Your ways need to be anchored. Your speech needs to be anchored. Your body needs to be anchored. Am I talking to anybody here that knows you need to be anchored in the Lord, that when the wind comes and take you, you don't got no, you won't move because you've been anchored in the Lord. We seen a song growing up. There's a storm out on the ocean and it's moving this old way. If your soul's not anchored in Jesus, you will surely drift away. I come to let somebody know, if you're not anchored in Jesus, you will drift away. The kingdom of God needs citizens that are anchored in the Lord. And when you're anchored in the Lord, you're not moved by every little thing that comes your way. The songwriter said, the billows may roll, the breakers may dance, but I shall not stray because he holds me fast. So dark the day is, clouds in the sky. I know it's all right because Jesus is mine. Anybody's soul's been anchored in the Lord. I've been anchored and I'm not so easily moved by anyone. You can talk about me just as much as you please, but the more you talk, I'm going to bend my knees. I will not be moved. I'll be just like a tree planted by the water. The people of God need to be anchored so that when the storms of this world and this life try to come up against you, we won't be thrown into the rocks that will cause us to be destroyed. It doesn't make sense that every little single thing makes the people of God afraid, throws the people of God off their course. It doesn't make sense that every little thing that comes our way, somebody don't like you, you depressed. You don't get enough likes on your post, you're moved, you're upset. You don't get an invitation somewhere, you're moved, you're upset. You don't get the promotion you want, you're upset. Somebody says you're ugly, your whole day's messed up. Somebody don't like what you got on, you're all messed up. Somebody say your body don't look the way you thought it should be, you're all messed up. Somebody doesn't like your hair, now you're off to the hairdresser. Somebody doesn't like your clothes, and now you go off to the store to get something new. But if you're anchored in God, people can say whatever they want to. People can say whatever they please. And you'll know that you'll be all right because you got a Savior that you're anchored to. Life can throw a million things at you, but you'll make a comeback every time. You've been anchored. You got to be anchored. Secondly, you can't abandon the ship prematurely. You can't abandon the ship prematurely. In verse 31, many reasons why people who choose to abandon ships in life is because you don't see things getting any better with your situation. And that was the same case with the sailors in this particular text. They saw the ship being battered and torn, and they thought to themselves, there's no way to survive here, but I come to let somebody know that there's safety on a troubled ship. Sailors back in those days didn't have radar and satellites that could help them navigate the seas. They didn't have it like we had it right now. They relied on the sun and stars to guide them through their voyages. Verse 20 says, it had been many days since they had seen either sun or stars. And since they didn't see the sun or the stars, they didn't know where they were at. They didn't know where they were headed. The winds and waves were battering them unmercifully, and they lost all hope of rescue. What do you do when you're on the ship of life going through a storm and you can't see the S-O-N? What do you do when you're in life and you don't feel like you can see the sun? They had lost all hope of being saved, so the sailors devised a plan to abandon the ship. And I come to let you know, anytime you yourself devise a plan, I can let you know that right then and there, that's going to end up in death. The sailor made a plan to try, and they tried to cover it up like they were letting more of the anchors down. And Paul, who had the Holy Ghost, and Paul, who knew and had a relationship with God, said, Paul said to them, if they don't stay with the ship, then we're all going down. You can't abandon ship because there are people that are depending on you. Your obedience is definitely someone else's deliverance. I come to let somebody know your obedience, the fact that you have hung in there, the fact that you've been long suffering, the fact that you've been holding on to God's unchanging hand is the reason why somebody else has been saved. You cannot abandon the ship prematurely. Look at somebody and say, hang in there. Lastly, you got to be anchored. You can't give in at the wrong time. But lastly, you've got to cut off all fatal lifelines. You can't go into 2024 with fatal lifelines. I know that sounds contrary, but it said in verse 232, it says, the sailors cut the line to the lifeboats. A lifeline is a thing on which someone or something depends on, or which provides a means of escape from a difficult situation. But the Bible says, there's a way that seemeth right unto men, but in the end, it leads to destruction. You need to cut the line, because if you don't, you'll find yourself trying to go back to it. So Paul told them, what y'all need to do is go ahead and cut the lines to the lifeboat altogether. Because if you keep the lifeboats on there, at some point in time, you're going to think you got to go back to it. And I come to let somebody know, you need to cut the lines to those fatal lifelines that you had in your life. You need to go ahead and just cut it so that you won't be going back to it. You're going to have to learn that everything that's available isn't applicable. I wish I had a praying church somewhere. Just because you have something that's available to you for use doesn't mean that you should go after it or have it. Just because the curse words are available to you don't mean you ought to go cussing people out. Just because that man is available to you, oh, I wish I had a praying church somewhere. But you're going to have to learn to cut off fatal lifelines. You're going to have to learn to cut off fatal lifelines that will cause you destruction. You're going to have to learn to cut off lifelines that will cause you to move backwards. You're going to have to learn to cut off lifelines that will cause you to backslide. You're going to have to learn to cut off lifelines that will cause you to fall back into old habits. I'm trying to encourage somebody that you've got to learn to cut off fatal lifelines so that you can be able to reach for the faithful lifeline. I'm moving from fatal to faithful. I wish I had a praying church that could help me here. I'm moving from my fatal ways to my faithful way maker. I'm moving from my fatal thoughts to my faithful mind regulator. Just in case you don't know who my lifeline is, he's the son of David. He's the seed of Abraham. Some call him the rose of Sharon. I know him to be the lily in the valley. I know him to be a bright and morning star. He's bread when I'm hungry and water when I'm thirsty. Anybody know that man? His name is Jesus. I wish I had a praying church that would start relying on Jesus, that would start relying on Jesus, start relying on his power, start relying on his strength. And if you call on Jesus, he'll make everything all right. If you call on Jesus, he'll make everything all right. And just in case you don't know who Jesus is, Jesus will be everything that you need him to be. He'll be a mother to the motherless. He'll be a father to the fatherless. He'll be a friend to the friendless. He'll be grace and mercy when you need it. I wonder if anybody know who he is. And I let you know that you can trust and depend on Jesus. Maybe that's why the old people used to sing that I will trust in the Lord until I die. I'm going to trust in the Lord until I die. I've learned how to lean and depend on Jesus. Anybody learn to depend and lean on Jesus? So lift up your heads, all ye gates, and be lifted up, ye everlasting doors, and the King of glory. Who is the King of glory? His name is Jesus. Say Jesus. If you know who he is, shout yeah. Shout yeah. Shout yeah. He'll keep you safe. Anybody know he'll keep you safe? Even on the trouble shit that we stand all over the building. We realize that 2023 has put us, a few of us, on some troubled ships. Put you on some troubled waters. But I come to let you know, if you hold the God's unchanging hand, he'll get you through the rough waters of life. Anybody know that? Anybody know that God will do that for you? All glory to God. Come on, let's give God praise that he's kept us safe. And we want to extend an invitation to anyone who's been battling the waters of life. And you may not even been battling. 2023 might have been a good year for you. And if that's the case, glory to God. And don't think that what God did this year is all that he can do. There's still more. Even you had a good year, there's still more. You had a bad year, there's still more. I come to let somebody know that as long as you keep Jesus on the ship, he'll help you through. So if there's anyone that needs to accept Jesus as a captain of your ship, we offer this time to you. you need to give your life over to God, or you need to be baptized in the waters of baptism, go down and come up a new creature, because the Bible says that any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. Amen. And if you're looking for a church home, Quinn Chapel is a great place to be. Oh, every Quinn Chapel member ought to clap their hands right then and there. Let me try that one more time. Oh, that was practice, all right. If you're looking for a church home, Quinn Chapel is a great place to be. Pastor Jermaine Covington is a good pastor to have. Glory to God. We offer this invitation to you. And it's me. This song. Come on, put your hands up together, people of God. Anchored in Jesus.
Come on, let's give God some praise all over this house. Hallelujah. Can we give God praise for the message and for the messenger? While you're clapping, let's give God praise for both of our psalmists and soloists who came tonight. Come on, let's thank God for our choir, our musicians, our liturgical dancers. Come on, let's celebrate. And now, before we leave, we pause for a moment of prayer. Because there's power in prayer. Have I got a witness here? And so, as Brother Everett plays an appropriate song, I ask you the question, is your all on the altar of sacrifice laid? Your all, does the Spirit control? You cannot have rest and be perfectly blessed until all on the altar is laid. I encourage you tonight, as you go into a new year and a new season, to take your burdens to the Lord and leave them there. If you would just make your way to the altar as we come, just laying aside every weight. As you make your way to this altar now, I encourage you to just throw those things over on the altar. Give those things to God, knowing that you can't fix it yourself, but the Lord is able. For sweet peace and for faith to increase, you have earnestly fervently prayed, but you cannot have rest and be perfectly blessed until all on the altar is laid. Come on, help me if you can. Burden over to the Lord. Give that trial over to the Lord. Give that marriage over to the Lord. Give that sickness over to the Lord. Oh, you can only be blessed and have Take somebody by the hand wherever you are. Take somebody by the hand wherever you are. Your body and soul. God, we come tonight. We come, God, as empty pitchers before a full fountain. God, we come tonight knowing that if we just trust in you, everything's gonna be all right. God, we come thanking you because you have been so good to us. In fact, you've been better to us than we've been to ourselves. And so, God, we come tonight with hearts that are full of thanksgiving. Oh, God, if I had 10,000 tongues, it wouldn't be enough to say thank you. And so, God, I come with a grateful heart tonight. And, God, I pray that in the name of Jesus, you would touch all over this sanctuary. God, somebody comes with a bowed down head and a troubled mind. But, God, we know you to be a mind regulator and a heart fixer. We know you to be shelter in the time of storm. God, move in us so that we have faith that everything's going to be all right. Touch that troubled home. Touch that troubled body. Touch that troubled mind. God, do what only you can do. Build a tunnel of hope through a mountain of despair. God, we need you to be exactly what you can be in our lives. God, as we go through 2024, we will walk by faith and not by sight. God, we're declaring and decreeing that better is coming in 2024. We're declaring increase in 2024. We're forgetting the former things and pressing towards the greater things because you've promised never to leave us alone. So God, lift up a bowed down head right now. God, give us strength where we're weak and build us up where we're torn down. God, I pray a special anointing on Quinn Chapel African Methodist Episcopal Church. God, shower down on this church like never before. I declare increase. I declare increase. I declare increase. I declare increase right now in the name of Jesus. Enlarge our territory. Strengthen us, God. Take our worship to the next level. Take our evangelism to the next level. Take our youth ministry to the next level. Take our choirs and our preaching to the next level. God, have your way in this place. In the name of Jesus. Satan, we're coming after your kingdom like never before. We're coming to tear your kingdom down. In the name of Jesus. That we might be a city set on a hill. And God, we thank you for what you have done. We thank you for what's in our rearview mirror. We thank you for what you've done in days past. But now, God, we also gonna thank you for what you're getting ready to do. We thank you for our mountains you're getting ready to tear down. We thank you for trouble you're getting ready to fix. We thank you for bullies you're getting ready to regulate. We thank you for our health that you're getting ready to somehow turn around. We thank you for the loan we're getting ready to receive. We thank you, God, for what you're getting ready to do in our lives. And God, we bless your name because there's power in the name of Jesus to break every chain, to break every chain, to break every chain, every 2023 chain. Every disease chain, every discouragement chain, every destruction chain, every yoke of bondage chain. God, we come now so that you can break every chain. In the name of Jesus. In the name of Jesus, I pray. And the people of God said, amen. Real, real
Jesus is real to me. Oh, yes, give me the victory. So many people doubt him. I can't live without him. That is why I love him so. He's so real to me. Everybody, he's real, real. Jesus is real to me. Give me the victory. So many people doubt him. I can't live without him. That is why I love him so. He's so real. In the morning, he's real, real. Jesus is real to me. So real. Come on, let's give God some glory in this house. Now, as we prepare to go, we're going into the fellowship hall for a New Year's celebratory meal. And so we're going to ask the preacher to come back now and share in our benediction. And then we also ask that he would bless the food. Let us stand.
God bless you all. Thank you for allowing me here to be with you all today. And we look forward to Queen Chapel coming to Philippian next year. So we pray to see your beautiful faces. Then let us pray. God, we thank you for blessing us, allowing us to be here. God, we ask that, God, you would continue to touch us. And God, that you would continue to provide the safety, God, when we're in these troubled places. And God, when we're even in our good places, God, we ask that you would continue to take us higher and higher. God, as Pastor Covington said, God, greater is on the way. And God, we want the increase that you have for us. God, we ask that you would bless the food, allow it to be nourishment to our bodies. God, allow us to get to our different destinations safe and sound. Now may the love of Jesus Christ, the grace of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit rest, rule, and abide henceforth, now and forevermore. We all say amen.
Amen.
Amen. God bless you. Thank you.